so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Confessing their sins. But when he saw many Pharisees and Sadducees will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will clear his threshing floor and will gather his wheat into the granary. But the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Let's see if I can get around the Advent wreath without knocking it over. Would you pray with me? We thank you, O God, for the gift of your love. And we offer and present to you, so far as we are able, all that we are, all that we have, and all that we do, as only an emptiness to be filled by you, until you are all in all and we are complete. Through the one who is the very fullness of your love, Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Well, today, before church, Justice brought me one of the most important things that we have as a symbol of Advent. A fire extinguisher, which I will happily return when Epiphany comes and we take down the Advent wreath. As you can tell, it's only in the second week of Advent, and it's already drying out a bit. This is our insurance, and let it be noted that if the church catches fire from the Advent wreath, it may be a little child that saves us. So thank you, Justice, for this wonderful presentation today. Insulated by 2,000 years and 5,000 miles of cultural differences, it may be simple for us just to accept our gospel lesson today on its face. In fact, we're used to hearing about John the Baptizer, accustomed to holding him in high esteem as the forerunner of Christ. John the Baptist, you see, has been sanitized and deodorized for our protection, much like the bathrooms and motels we stay in. But if you were a first century Jew living in Palestine, you would think that John the Baptist was at least eccentric, and maybe even used a term such as a crackpot. Think about it for just a minute. If you were going to start a ministry, would you go out in the wilderness to do it? We don't have anything like the wilderness in Israel in these parts. We don't know what desolate is compared to what they have over Israel. The wilderness there is rock and sand everywhere, no water, no trees, no grass to speak of. It's not luxurious like our forests here. It's desert, bordered by small mountains jutting up in the middle of hot burning sand. In fact, the Greek word that describes the wilderness is eremos. It means lonesome, waste, desolate, solitary. Desert or wilderness. John could have chosen to draw a big crowd in bustling Jerusalem or in the big-time seaport of Caesarea Maritima or even the camel trade oasis of Jericho or even Capernaum on the north shore of the Sea of Galilee where Peter and Jesus lived as adults. So who in their right mind would go out into the dry, hot, lonesome, solitary, sandy desert to preach? Minimally, John was eccentric. In modern terms, instead of starting a television ministry where he could reach millions of people, John chose to go out into the middle of empty Death Valley, preaching to the sand and the rocks and the lizards and the snakes. The second reason that a good Jewish person of Jesus' time would think that John the Baptist was eccentric was that he was running around baptizing Jews, God's chosen people. In that time, proselytes, converts to Judaism, were bathed in the mikvah, their ceremonial bath, and even Jewish people might bathe in a mikvah to purify themselves after they were unclean, like after they come into contact with the grave. But if you were a Jewish person, circumcised as an infant and raised in the Jewish faith, you were a child of Abraham. There was no reason to go through an initiation rite into Judaism, because you were already Jewish. But this weirdo named John was running around the wilderness doing initiation rites on people who were already Jewish. It would be as crazy as rebaptizing the Pope. A totally eccentric and bizarre thing to do. It was an insult to Judaism at the very least. Another eccentric thing about this guy, he was dressed in camel's hair with a leather girdle around his waist. Everybody in Jesus' time knew that that was how the prophet Elijah had dressed some 800 years before John the Baptist. In 2 Kings chapter 1, verse 8, King Ahaziah is wondering, who is this prophet who is giving him all this trouble? So he asked his folks, what kind of man was he who came to meet you and told you those things? They answered him, he wore a garment of hair cloth with a girdle of leather about his loins. So John is dressing like Elijah from centuries earlier. Now Elijah was supposed to return before the terrible day of the Lord, when God would come back and judge the earth. The prophet Malachi says that God said, behold, I send you the prophet Elijah before the great and terrible day of the Lord comes. So here comes John the Baptist running around the desert dressed like Elijah. I mean, it was a peculiar way for Elijah to dress when Elijah did it 800 years earlier. And it would be like if someone today ran around Death Valley dressed in a medieval suit of armor, seriously claiming to be the new King Arthur, you know. And to top it all off, John the Baptist ate weird food. Bugs from the desert, and honey that he found in the beehives under the rocks. So here is John running around the desert, preaching to the rocks, baptizing people who were already good Jews, dressed up like Elijah, eating bugs and goo he found under the rocks. He was definitely a candidate for the fun farm. But the really strange thing is that it worked. People actually came out to hear John preach. Both Matthew and Mark say that John's preaching attracted all the Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem. And Matthew says that the people from all the region around the Jordan River also came. So in spite of being peculiar, John was successful. Later on, Matthew describes the folks who came out to see John as tax collectors and harlots, the sinful people from the wrong side of the tracks. That's in chapter 21 of Matthew. They were not the good people who sacrificed and tithe and made absolutely sure they obeyed the commandments of the law of Moses. The people who came to hear John were not the good folks who went to the temple to pray and fast and did all the things they were supposed to do. Curious about this strange guy out in the wilderness doing strange stuff, some of the good guys, the Pharisees and the Sadducees, the people who took their Jewish faith seriously, came out to see what was going on. And how are they greeted? What does this eccentric John the Baptist do? He calls the good guys who came out to see him a bunch of poisonous snakes. He calls them a brood of vipers. He calls the pillars of society, the good temple-going folks, the folks that belong to the first century equivalent of the Junior League and the PTA and the Chamber of Commerce, who volunteer at the hospital and belong to the Lions and Kiwanis and Rotary Clubs and give to the United Way. He calls them a bunch of poisonous snakes. Not exactly a way to greet people. And he asked the good guys, who warned you to flee from the wrath that is to come? He says you better repent and don't rely on your goodly heritage. You'd better do the works that are the fruit of repentance, because someone is coming who is going to separate the wheat from the chaff, and he'll gather the good stuff in the granary and burn up you trash. What a strange thing to do. What do you suppose he meant? And do you suppose that John the Baptist has anything to say to us 2,000 years later and 5,000 miles away? Arlen Holtgren, who's the New Testament professor at Luther Northwestern Seminary in Minneapolis, says this. Minneapolis is where all good Lutherans live. In matters of faith, it is easy to become smug on the basis of our roots. Our ancestors in faith may go back many generations, even centuries. But John the Baptist's words to his contemporaries also speak to us. We should not presume to speak or think about the fidelity of our ancestors as accruing to our credit, for the axe is laid to the root. Roots don't count. Each of us stands before God as an individual. I think that Dr. Holgren is right. It's easy to become nostalgic or smug about our ancestors' good works. It's easy to point, particularly in the Episcopal Church, to the people who started hospitals, like St. Peter's Hospital today, better known today as the Carolinas Medical Center. Do you know we started that? Our orphanages, our private schools and colleges, it's easy to point to the things that our ancestors have done. All those are fine and dandy. And I'm sure that William Augustus Muhlenberg, who founded St. Luke's Hospital in New York City and worked with the poor, is in heaven right now. But when I get there and stand before the great judgment of the seat of Christ, God ain't going to much care what William Augustus Muhlenberg does. He's going to say to you, Ed, what did you do? What did you do on the face of this earth? You know, the good trees that bore the good fruit. But the axe is laid to the root of the trees. We cannot rely on the good fruit that our ancestors might have done. We have to rely on our own faith, as demonstrated by the works that we do. As Martin Luther put it, good works do not make a person good, but a good person does good works. What is called for, according to John the Baptizer, is repentance. Now, we associate repentance with the sinful life, but the Greek word that's used throughout the New Testament for repentance is metanoia, and it simply means changing your mind. Try that one out. Turning your mind around. Metanoia doesn't necessarily imply that we need to feel remorse about what we've done in the past, or even that we've been guilty of some kind of sin. It just means that we've changed our mind about everything, and we're turning our lives around. We're changing the direction of our life. Now, you don't have to be Jack the Ripper to do that. You don't have to be the extortionist tax collector that Matthew refers to. And if we ever dare think that we don't need to change our mind to redirect our thoughts towards doing God's work, then maybe we are the brood of snakes dripping the poisonous venom of complacency, the disgusting self-satisfaction of the me generation, the venom of the one who dies with the most boys wins. You've heard that. The truth is that the one who dies with the most toys is still dead. What must God think about a world that is simultaneously full of billionaires and starving children at the same time? Think about that. What must God think of a world like we are? No matter how good we might be, there's always room to be better, to turn around. Because metanoia is the continual process of re-examining and redirecting our lives more and more and more towards doing what God would have us do. Not because we ever get it right, because we don't. We never earn our ticket to paradise. But because good works are just the kind of things that happen when good people are in the neighborhood. Good works just sort of happen when folks concentrate on God and are willing to change our minds about everything else. They're not our ticket to the granary of heaven instead of the blast furnace of hell. Jesus is our ticket. But the good works are just the byproduct of the ride that we go on, the continual process of reorienting ourselves toward God and away from the world. They're just a sweet-smelling residue when people who love God pass by. So, as St. Augustine said the sermon in just a few words, love God and do what you want to. Because if you truly love God, you will do what is right. Amen. Please stand and join in the words of the Nicene Creed found in your bulletin.
Lord, the eyes of all people to behold thy thy gracious hand in all thy works, that, rejoicing in thy whole creation, they may honor thee with their substance and be faithful stewards of thy bounty. And we most humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor Paul, April, Michelle, Dana, Francis, Bella, Elaine, Ron, Father Brad, Philip, and all those who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. And we also bless thy holy name for all thy servants departed this life in thy faith and fear, especially Wesley, Beau, and Kitty, beseeching thee to grant them continual growth in thy love and service, and to grant us grace so to follow the good examples of St. Paul and of all the saints, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant these our prayers, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate.
Amen.
Saturday, Lighthouse Restaurant. The men's group is going to meet for breakfast. If anybody, any man in the middle of the church, we probably wouldn't even kick a woman in the church out if you can't see. But 8:30 in the palace, we're going to have breakfast, so feel free to join us.
And Wednesday at 10:30, just like every Wednesday, there'll be a Bible study. So please do come if you're able to on Wednesday morning at 10:30. And
Sure. Yeah, of course I have an answer. Sorry. I'm sure Nancy, and that's a good thing. So I hope that especially today you will come to the prayer hall for coffee hour, because I implore you for your help. Late last week, I received the names of three boys from the Christmas Bureau, and we are responsible for all their Christmas this year. It feels like a very heavy responsibility, and we need all of your help to do that. There's an angel tree down there, and if you'll look at the gifts on the angel tree and pick out something that suits you, I hope some of you know where to locate Pokemon cards, because they seem to be a very big thing. But in any case, it could. Okay, correct. If you will come down and look at the gift request, we would appreciate it very much. Simply take the gift with you, write your name on a list by the number that corresponds to the number of the gift, and bring it back, oh my goodness, by the 8th, which is, I believe, Thursday of this week or Friday. So it's a very quick turnaround, but they didn't give you the names until just this week, so I apologize for the short notice. But I know that St. Paul has always held this in dear regard. And since Lisa is in here, I'm just going to say the ladies group is also meeting next Saturday at 10. I'm not sure what time, 10 o'clock.
Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Lift up your heart.
Lift them up unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto our Lord God.
It is meet and right so to do.
It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, Everlasting God. Because thou didst send thy beloved Son to redeem us from sin and death, and to make us heirs in him of everlasting life, that when he shall come again in power and great triumph to judge the world, we may without shame or fear rejoice to behold his appearing. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, this our